Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to do this. My talk is celiac disease and gluten-associated disorders. So in terms of the learning objectives, hopefully by the end of this talk, you should be able to define celiac disease, understand what the clinical manifestations of celiac disease are, understand some basic pathophysiology. Then I thought it would be nice to try to understand the difference between celiac disease, non-celiac gluten sensitivity, and wheat allergy, since it's something that we hear about a lot these days. And also understanding how we make the diagnosis and how we treat celiac disease and become familiar with some of the exciting non-dietary therapies that are in the pipeline. And also to become familiar with some of the research interests at Stanford. So what is celiac disease? We'll begin with some definitions. Basically, celiac disease is a permanent intolerance to gluten. And in celiac disease, there is damage to the lining of the small intestine, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that. And it's secondary to an inappropriate response to gluten. It's also called celiac sprue, gluten-sensitive enteropathy, and non-tropical sprue. Just a few highlights. There's a lot to the history, but these are some that I thought were important highlights. So the earliest description was attributed to Aratus of Cappadocia, and according to the history books, it's the first to the second century AD. And the word celiac actually is derived from the Greek celiacos, which means abdominal. And many years later, when his works were translated, it was found that there was a description of a disease dating back to the first century AD that was probably celiac disease. Now, origin of the modern history of celiac disease was attributed to Samuel Gee, who in 1887 spoke on the celiac affection. And he very concisely and very clearly described the disease process in terms of the stool and the nature of the disease. And interestingly, he also made a recommendation at the time that maybe diet was the answer to this. And that's pretty striking. In the 1950s, it was Dr. William Dickey who showed that the elimination of wheat, rye, and oats led to dramatic improvement of the medical condition. And they noted also that wheat starch didn't really cause much of a damaging effect. Thus, the culprit was thought to be protein, and this was proven later on. The histological or microscopic changes that we attribute to celiac disease were also demonstrated conclusively in the 1950s. First using surgical specimen, and then oral biopsies became available. And now we routinely diagnose the disease by taking biopsies with endoscopies, which we're gonna talk more about. Concordance among identical twins led to the suspicion that there was a genetic component. And many years later, the HLA, human leukocyte antigen genes, were found to be indeed very important. Circulating antibodies to gluten were reported in the 1950s as well. A few other highlights. In the 70s, then we had antibodies that were a little bit more specific, and these were reticulin antibodies. In the 1980s, then we had anti-endomysial antibody, which we're going to talk more about this in a little while. But also there was the discovery that these genes, HLA-DQ2 and DQ8, were major risk factors and it kind of changed the way we think about the disease. In 1997 was another big hallmark in that the autoantigen that's responsible for celiac disease was discovered and identified as tissue transglutaminase. Subsequent to this, there have been a lot of studies which have shown which parts of gluten are important to activate the immune response. Not so long ago, there were genome-wide studies that identified other genes aside from the HLA genes that are important for the risk of developing celiac disease. And at present, there are actually ongoing clinical trials on drug therapies to treat celiac disease that are different from the traditional way of treating this with gluten exclusion. So what is gluten? Gluten encompasses the storage protein in wheat, rye, and barley. And gluten is a proline and glutamine-rich protein that in celiac disease activates the immune response, and we'll talk about how that happens. It's high in proline, and the proline content makes it so that it's resistant to digestive enzymes. And it's part of the reason why it remains intact and it's able to activate the immune response. This is one of my favorite cartoons of gluten. And it basically shows that it's made up of two components. There's the gliadins and the glutenins. And basically, when gluten sees water, these two components form an elastic bond. And it's what allows bread to rise without falling apart. But if you have celiac disease, then the prolamin, which in wheat is actually called gliadin, is toxic to you. And we'll talk about how that is. Now, the prolamin varies in name in wheat, barley, and rye. For instance, in wheat, we know it as gliadin. In rye, we know it as succulins. And in hordains and barley. However, in celiac disease, all three forms of gluten are immunoreactive. So I thought I would pepper this talk with a few of the common myths that we encounter. And the first is that celiac is a rare disease. And the fact is that it's not. The prevalence is quite high, and in the United States, it's actually approaching about 1%. Most of the cases remain undiagnosed. In the United States, about 1 in 133 individuals have celiac disease. And among these, among people who have first-degree relatives with celiac disease, that risk is a lot higher, and quoted at 1 in 22. And you may be familiar with this, and this is the concept that right now, even though our diagnostic tests are a lot better and the awareness for celiac disease is better, we still are dealing with just the tip of the iceberg. And most cases of celiac disease probably remain undiagnosed. And there's several reasons for this. So to understand what the problem is in celiac disease, I think it's important to understand a little bit about small intestinal physiology. What you have here is a cartoon of the digestive tract. We have the esophagus that connects to the stomach, which subsequently connects to the small intestine. And the small intestine is kind of nicely organized in the middle of the abdominal cavity. Here's the colon and rectum. The small intestine is a very important organ. It is approximately 20 to 22 feet long. It's a very long hollow tube, and a lot of really important minerals and micronutrients are absorbed in the small intestine. So most of your nutrients are absorbed in the small intestine. Also, the small intestine houses a lot of our mucosal immune system. So this is a cartoon of the intestine, and again, it's a long hollow tube. It's the lining is what we call the mucosa, and it's where nutrients are absorbed. We also have muscle layers, an inner circular, outer longitudinal, and we have a serosal surface, which is the outside. Now, the surface area of the small intestine is immense, and it's organized, the lining is organized in small villi, which are finger-like projection, which in a sense increase the surface area, increases the absorptive capacity. And here is basically of what a villi would look like in high magnification. And what I want to point out here is that these cells that line the villus, they're called enterocytes or epithelial cells. And at the core of the villi, what we have is the blood supply. So this is veins and arteries, lymphatics. In addition, you can't see it here, but our immune cells are there as well. This is a picture from microscope, under the microscope. And what you can see here are the epithelial cells. And these cells here that you see, the dark dots here, those are all immune cells. And one thing that is important to understand is that in the small intestine, all that separates all these immune cells from all the contents in the lumen is this single epithelial cell barrier. And this, a problem in these cells is really what results in, contributes to the development of celiac disease, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that. So like other complex diseases, celiac disease is a component of various factors, including genetics, immunity, in both adaptive, which is basically a hardwired, evolutionarily preserved response to pathogens and stimuli, and the adaptive immune response, which is a more specific acquired immunity. So both are important for celiac disease. Also, this is an interplay with the environment. In this case, we're talking about gluten, but there's probably other factors at play, and we'll see why. Now, genetics, it has been shown to be very important, and these two genes, HLA DQ2 and DQ8, that are expressed in certain immune cells called antigen-presenting cells, are extremely important. And virtually all patients who have celiac disease carry one of these two genes. And this is in the order of 99.9. However, just having these genes doesn't mean that you'll have the disease. And we'll talk a little bit more about why that is. So one of the common questions that I get, it's very common for people to have their genes tested, 23andMe and such, and they carry the genes for celiac disease. So the question is, does this mean you have celiac disease? And the answer is that no, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have the disease, it just tells you that you have risk for developing the disease. And a little bit more on the genetic component here. So first degree relatives, there's 10 to 15% concordance. And when you look at monozygotic identical twins versus dizygotic non-identical twins, there's much higher concordance in the monozygotic twins than in dizygotic twins, where it's more around the same level of first degree relatives. So that there tells you that genetics is an important component. However, the HLA DQ2 and DQ8 genes explain only 35 to 40% of the heritability. And again, these genes basically are expressed on cells that are called antigen-presenting cells. These are the cells that actually bind gliadin, or the toxic component of gluten, and subsequently activate the immune response, or the T cells. And we'll see how that happens. And the remaining 60% are thought to be due to non-HLA genes. And a lot of these genes are probably other genes involved in the immune response, and probably some that we don't yet, in some processes that we don't yet understand. Now, to drive in the point that HLA, DQ2, and DQ8 are necessary but not sufficient, this pie chart looks basically at what proportion of the population at large carries HLA, DQ2. So I mentioned that both HLA and DQ2 are important to develop celiac disease. Now, the vast majority of patients who have celiac disease, in the order of 95%, carry HLA, DQ2. HLA DQ8 accounts for the other 5%. So this is looking just at HLA DQ2, and about 25% of the population carries HLA DQ2. But what's interesting is that of those individuals, only about 4% go on to develop celiac disease. The vast majority are healthy, and of those 4%, the most people, when on a gluten-free diet, go on to have an uncomplicated course. Now, if we combine HLA DQ2 and DQ8, now we're talking about 30 to 40% of the population, but this proportion still holds, where about 4 to 5% of that population develop celiac disease. So clearly there are other factors. And though what those factors are still remains an open question. Okay, so this is a little bit of a busy slide, but it's in a summary of what we understand about the pathophysiology of celiac disease. So just to orient you, these cells here are those special epithelial cells or enterocytes that I showed you that make up the that line the villi. And what you have here is what we call the luminal surface. So that is the inside of the small intestine where you would expect to find whatever you've ingested and whatever secretions our cells make. And what's separating all of this in the lumen from the immune cells, which are found beneath the epithelial cells, and this is called the lamina propria, is this single cell layer. And what happens in celiac disease is, for reasons that we don't understand, gliadin, again, which is the toxic component of gluten, gains access to the lamina propria, presumably because we do understand that people with celiac disease have increased permeability. So the junctions between the cells are actually looser in patients with celiac disease. Now, that remains a big question about that is whether the people with celiac disease have a leaky gut, if you will. And is that why they develop the disease? Because now gliadin is more likely to pass through the lamina propria? Or if this increased permeability that we know happens in active celiac disease is a consequence of the inflammation that ensues. We're not 100% sure of what the answer is to that, and that's one of the focus of current research. But gliadin enters the lamina propria. Once it's in the lamina propria, it comes in contact with an enzyme called tissue transglutaminase, which is ubiquitous. But what this protein does is that takes prolines and deaminates them. So it modifies gliadin, because if you remember, gliadin is very rich in prolines. And this modified version of gliadin then has higher affinity for this HLA-DQ2 protein that we know are in these specialized cells called antigen-presenting cells. And gliadin presented to the T cells, which are specialized immune cells, then causes an activation of the immune response. So what does that mean? What happens is that this leads to release of cytokines that are chemicals that have varied functions, also leads to activation of certain immune cells and cause them to migrate in between the epithelial cells. These are called intraepithelial lymphocytes, and there are CD8 cells. Now, these cells are important because they have been shown to be toxic to these cells, and it's part of the reason why we think that there's destruction of the epithelial cells. Also, B cells, which are responsible for making antibodies, are activated. And antibodies against tissue transglutaminase and gliadin are made. Now, these antibodies don't protect us, but these are the markers that are that we pick up in the blood that help us diagnose the disease. So a simple, overly simplistic way to think about this is that, in a sense, our body is, our immune system is misreading gliadin as a potential pathogen. So you could imagine that if your immune cells think that gliadin is a pathologic bacteria or a pathogen, let's say salmonella or something like that, then if you just ate a slice of bread, it's going to be lining the small intestine, and this is where the immune response is going to be directed. So the consequence of the activation of the immune response is destruction of the lining of the small intestine. So in a sense, it's friendly fire. And this is to illustrate that a little bit more clearly. I thought this picture is a little bit clearer on this. So this is a cartoon of the villi and the crypts in profile. So this is the villi are the peaks, and what we call the crypt is these valleys. And this is where the cells that eventually make up the crypt are made. So what happens in celiac disease, again, to walk you through this, here's gluten, gliadin, it gets through to the epithelial cells, it comes into contact with the immune cells, it activates the immune response, and activates these special cells. And every time this happens, it causes injury to the lining of the small intestine. So repeated exposure to gluten causes injury to the lining to the point that the villi are completely destroyed. Now, the body is trying to make more cells to create more villi, so what you get in very severe celiac disease is that the villi are completely gone and the crypts are very, very deep. Okay, and the consequence of that. So this is normally when I look inside the intestine, what we see. So the consequence of the inflammation is literally destruction of the lining of the small intestine. And what you should see normally on the left here is that the small intestine has a velvety texture to it. It has very delicate villi that have the appearance of a lush rug or carpet. Immersed under water, the villi almost look like the fingers of a sea anemone. And my fellows will tell you that I always comment on how beautiful the small intestine is. Now, in celiac disease, you have destruction of that architecture. And what you have now is that the mucosal surface, there's gaps, which we call scalloping. And you see that how the lining looks more smooth. You don't see the velvet texture. You don't see individual villi. And this notch pattern that we see here is what we call scalloping. It could also look very nodular or very bumpy. And this is another manifestation of that here, where you have these mucosal depressions, which are areas that are devoid of villi. So when the small intestine looks like this, it has a very good absorptive capacity. However, it loses a lot of that with repeated injury when it results, when this happens. And because the small intestine is where we absorb so many nutrients, it's not surprising that consequences of celiac disease include malnutrition, there's malabsorption of important nutrients, anemia, because it's where iron is absorbed, osteoporosis, because fat-soluble vitamins, vitamin D namely, are absorbed in the small intestine. Liver function abnormalities we see as well. We don't understand exactly what the mechanism of this is, but we think it might be something related to at the level of the autoimmune component. So I told you when we were talking about the pathophysiology that a lot of the damage we think occurs because of activation of the immune response. Another open question out there is like what the role of these antibodies that we use as diagnostic tests, what they're doing in the disease process, whether they are just markers of the disease or they actually have a role in causing some of this damage. That's not really understood. In individuals with celiac disease, there is an increase in small intestinal malignancy. Thankfully, that drops off the farther out you go with the diagnosis, presumably because of the intervention, which is the gluten-free diet. Now, malignancy is cancer. And there are special circumstances where we worry about malignancy. We'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Interestingly, there's also an association with other autoimmune disorders, including type 1 diabetes, Hashimoto's, autoimmune liver disease, rheumatoids, Down syndrome, Turner's, Addison's, and we don't quite understand why that is. And again, this might be something that has to do something with the autoimmune component. And there is a lot of interest in studying celiac disease because here is the one disease that we understand starts from an inflammatory response and culminates in autoimmunity. So if we understand how that's happening, maybe we'll gain insights as to what's happening in these diseases. Okay, so one of the big myths is that celiac disease always manifests with gastrointestinal symptoms. And the fact is that that's not necessarily the case, and that celiac disease has a very broad disease spectrum. And while GI symptoms are common, some patients have little or no intestinal symptoms, even if there is intensive damage to the lining of the intestines. And I can't tell you how many times I see patients who tell me, like, do I really have to be on a gluten-free diet? I feel fine, despite there being significant injury.
And there's actually several classifications of celiac disease, and this keeps on changing as we get together and understand the disease a little bit more. But some patients are asymptomatic, and these cases sometimes are the individuals that we screen because they have a first-degree relative who has celiac disease. And sometimes, even on direct questioning, there's no symptoms at all. Classical celiac disease is what we learn as the classical disease, which Dr. Gee described: diarrhea, steatorrhea, weight loss, and growth failure in children. Non-classical disease, which we sometimes is referred as atypical, is symptoms are not necessarily in the GI tract. So these are extraintestinal manifestations. And there is a form of celiac disease that's called dermatitis or pediformis, where essentially the same process that's happening in the intestines is occurring in the skin. There's also something known as gluten ataxia that we understand a little less of. But the understanding is that there might be also a gluten-induced reaction that causes damage to the lining of the brain. And obviously, the brain is less accessible an organ, so it's not as readily studied. Some people would fit under subclinical, where they're below the threshold of clinical detection. And then there's refractory sprue. Refractory sprue is individuals who continue to have symptoms and active disease despite being in a gluten-free diet. Now, one of the challenges in clinical practice is that it's really hard to exclude hidden gluten from a diet. And there's clearly a learning curve in adopting a gluten-free diet because it's not very easy. But in some cases, even if we confirm that there's no gluten exposure and there continues to be disease activity, we worry about refractory celiac disease. And in some of these patients with refractory sprue, they actually have a very aggressive form which could culminate in cancer, so we are very vigilant about those individuals. Potential celiac disease is an interesting group in where the blood tests are positive, but when you look at the small intestine, it looks perfectly normal. And there's debate as to whether we should put these individuals on a gluten-free diet or if we just watch and wait. And in this pie chart, what you see is that the vast majority of patients do present with GI symptoms, and diarrhea is actually very common. However, a good percentage we pick up on screening, so they may not necessarily have any symptoms. And that the clinical presentation could be very varied. So one of the struggles that we have is that a lot of times individuals who have symptoms that are typical of celiac are misdiagnosed as having irritable bowel syndrome, so it could be years before we make the accurate diagnosis. Okay, a little bit about mechanisms of gluten intolerance when it's not celiac disease. And then we'll talk a little bit more about how we diagnose celiac disease and the therapy. So celiac disease myth: celiac disease, wheat allergy, and non-celiac gluten sensitivity are the same thing. So the fact is that they're not. They're actually very distinct entities. And this slide is a little busy, but it's from a review article in the New England Journal in 2012. And it kind of illustrates the similarities and the differences between the three entities. What I will start by saying is that the symptoms could actually be very similar. So maybe they may be difficult to distinguish just from the symptoms, because in all three situations, gluten is thought to cause symptoms. However, there's several important differences. First of all, timing. In celiac disease, as we saw, it takes repeated exposure to gluten, cause mucosal damage that then results in the disease process. And that's weeks to years. Gluten sensitivities may be hours to days, where wheat allergy is almost instantaneous because of the mechanism. With regards to pathogenesis, we have a much better understanding of what's going on with celiac disease, and we know that both innate and adaptive immunity are important. gluten sensitivity, as we will talk about in a little bit, less known about it. And one of the struggles that we have with this is that we really don't have any biomarkers, and the pathogenic mechanisms are not understood. So it's hard to really figure out exactly how to treat these. Wheat allergy is what we know as a classic allergy response. Those genes that I told you about really apply to celiac disease, although a lot of individuals who are sensitive to gluten who don't have celiac disease will carry those genes as well. They're not a factor in wheat allergy. Autoantibodies are only present in celiac disease, and enteropathy, which means mucosal damage, is one of the things that distinguishes celiac disease from these two entities. And finally, there are long-term complications from active celiac disease that we don't see in the other conditions. This is a cartoon of wheat allergy. So wheat allergy is very uncommon. And actually, there is something that's called exercise-induced wheat anaphylaxis, which is exactly that, where you will consume wheat and then work out, exercise, and that induces an allergic reaction. It's extremely rare, but the mechanism here is very different from what we see in celiac disease. And what you have is IgE receptors, which are special receptors that we find in allergy-type cells, and these are mast cells and also eosinophils. And these cells are basically bags of enzymes that are toxic. And normally these cells are supposed to protect us from parasites, but in this case what happens is that when a patient ingests the allergen, which in this case would be wheat, it's recognized by the IgE receptors. That leads to activation and degranulation. So all these toxic granules degranulate, and this is what we know as an allergy. So there's sneezing, nasal congestion, there's swelling of the mucous membrane, difficulty breathing, and it can, in an extreme form, is what we call anaphylaxis, which could be life-threatening. So this is not what celiac disease is. Non-celiac gluten sensitivity is a bit more ambiguous. There is not a precise and widely agreed upon definition. And basically, in most cases, it's self-reported symptoms in response to gluten, and they result in a gluten-free diet. The symptoms could be very subjective, but include abdominal pain, headache, brain fog, tingling, numbness in the extremities, and pain, which could be very similar to what patients with celiac disease could experience. But rash, diarrhea, severe neurologic and psychiatric conditions have been reported. There's not extensive literature on this, so we don't really understand the underlying mechanisms. And the big problem that we have is that we don't have any biomarkers or diagnostic tests. So there's proposals as to how we can make the diagnosis of non-celiac gluten sensitivity. And this is such. So the first part of the algorithm, whenever there's a suspicion of gluten sensitivity, is to actually exclude celiac disease and wheat allergy. And if there isn't such, then one can then start a gluten-free diet and see if there's clinical improvement. And that would give you a provisional diagnosis. Reintroduce gluten, see if symptoms recur, and that would give you a more definitive diagnosis. So this is problematic because, as you probably can tell, there's going to be a placebo effect. And really, if we want to do this right, what we need to do, what they advocate would be to do a double-blind, placebo-controlled, where they basically would give two different kinds of allergens to elicit whether there's a response. Now, the way I practice, my feeling is that if somebody's having a reaction to gluten, and even if it's not celiac disease, if it's not something that they're not going to tolerate, then obviously there's something going on. It might be, it may not be something that I can, that I could do a blood test for, but I basically work with the patient the best that I can. And in some instances, in some individuals, will actually tolerate some forms of wheat products, but not others. So it's, and some people are can be a little bit more adventurous and will want to try different brands of certain products, and other individuals will want to remain on a gluten-free diet. And my concern is to make sure that the diet is varied enough that they are not deficient in important nutrients. So what is the prevalence of gluten intolerance? For celiac disease, we know that the prevalence is approaching 1% in the United States. For the estimated prevalence of non-celiac gluten sensitivity is a little less clear, because again, we're trying to figure out exactly what's happening here. And the studies suggest anywhere from 0.5 to 6%. And this, and probably we're not gonna have a good estimate until we understand this a little bit more and we actually have biomarkers. What are the mechanisms that have been postulated and are being studied as why could individuals be sensitive to gluten but not have celiac disease? Well, the answer is that we don't quite know yet, but these are a lot of the theories. There is actually no conclusive evidence that gluten itself is the trigger, and that it is possible that there might be a response to another protein in wheat. Also, it's been postulated that maybe there is, so in celiac disease, we have both the innate immune response, which is the immediate response to threat, that we have that it's evolutionarily preserved and hardwired. But then that is followed by activation of the adaptive immune response. So one of the thoughts is that perhaps, for reasons that we don't understand, in patients who have celiac gluten sensitivity, perhaps the innate immune response is reactive, but the for whatever reason, the adaptive immune response is not being activated. And it has been postulated that also there may be an unknown cell-mediated immune response to wheat protein. And part of the problem that we have is that it's very difficult to measure precise responses in the GI tract because it's such an immense immune organ. So it'll take some time. And also, part of what's thought is that wheat has complex carbohydrates, and that it may be the carbohydrate effect that could be causing the problem. So we'll talk a little bit more about that. So this is a busy slide, but it's basically all of the theories that that are being tested right now to try to figure out how wheat is causing symptoms. And on this arm is more of what we see some in celiac disease, where specific gliadin peptides can be causing direct injury to epithelial cells. So people have actually studied biopsy specimen with different gliadin peptides and have shown direct effects on the immune cells, including zonulin, which is a protein that it's in the tight junctions of epithelial cells. So what may be happening is that there's a direct toxic effect, not necessarily the same peptides that mediate celiac disease, but the other possibility is that there may be contaminants in gluten and that these have direct effect in the nervous system of the gut. And these could lead to motility abnormalities and also secretion, thereby causing diarrhea. Finally, other components of wheat could, like wheat amylase trypsin inhibitors, could have a direct or an indirect effect in the enteric nervous system that culminate in abnormalities. And finally, the wheat carbohydrates, by what's been called the FODMAP effect, and I'm going to talk to you a little bit more about that, can cause symptoms that way. So what are FODMAP? So I just said wheat is a FODMAP, and you're probably thinking, what is a FODMAP? So FODMAP is an anagram for fermentable oligosaccharides, disaccharides, monosaccharides, and polyols. And basically, these are complex carbohydrates that we humans don't digest very well. So they are small enough to be osmotically active. In other words, they could draw water into the small intestine, and they essentially go untouched through the small intestine into the colon, where then they are fermented by bacteria. Most of the work on FODMAPs is out of Australia. And actually, the same group that studied non-celiac gluten sensitivity went back and looked to see if individuals who had symptoms with and got better on a gluten-free diet, whether you corrected for the FODMAPs, whether the problem was the carbohydrate or the gluten itself. And their study seemed to suggest that that more likely it was more the carbohydrate component that was causing the problem there. And wheat is actually the biggest FODMAP in our diet. It has what are called fructans. So one possibility is that in some individuals who have a sensitivity to gluten, when they omit, who have a response to the gluten-free diet, is that when they omit gluten from their diet, they have removed some of the FODMAPs. And the idea here is not that you are intolerant to one food. It's more that everybody has a special threshold. And once you exceed that threshold, then there'll be symptoms. And that's overly simplistically. Obviously, it's going to be a little bit more complicated than that. So is elimination diet the best method of distinguishing between celiac disease, wheat allergy, and non-celiac gluten sensitivity? And the answer to that is no, because they will all get better. And then we won't know what the mechanism is. So now let's talk a little bit about how we make the diagnosis of celiac disease. So we start with blood tests. So we are lucky to have very good screening tests. What we look at is the antibodies that are made against tissue transglutaminase, which is that protein that modifies gluten, and also antibodies against deaminated gliadin peptide. So that's the part of gluten that in celiac disease is toxic. Sometimes we use some antibodies called anti-endomysium antibodies that are older type antibodies, but the advantage there, sometimes we use these when the diagnosis is uncertain, because when they're positive, the likelihood of having, they're highly specific, meaning that if they're present, then the likelihood of having celiac disease is very, very high. And this table kind of tells you that. So whenever we're looking at screening tests, we look at sensitivity and specificity. Sensitivity tells us how likely we'll be able to pick up the disease. And specificity is when the test is positive, how often is it accurate? With the anti-TTG antibodies, the specificity and sensitivity exceed 95%, which is very good. So we have very low false negatives. When we look at anti-endomysial antibody, the sensitivity is a little less, but the specificity is very high. And again, it's in situations where we don't have all of the parts and we still suspect that we would use that test as well. In the GI tract, the antibody that's important is most active is IgA. But in about 10% of patients with celiac disease, they are IgA deficient, so we rely on IgG versions of these tests, which are not as sensitive and specific, but can be very helpful in that situation. Now, HLA DQ2 and DQ8, we do use it sometimes in a diagnostic setting, and a lot of the individuals that I see are already on a gluten-free diet, and we're trying to, and they're interested in knowing whether they truly have celiac disease or if it's another category. And in this instance, HLA, DQ2, or DQ8 testing can be very helpful because remember, they're present in virtually all patients with celiac disease. So if they are not present, then the likelihood of this being celiac disease it's very low. And, you know, you may argue, well, if I feel better on a gluten-free diet, why do I need to know whether a celiac disease or not? And the reason that we do test is because, remember, it's with celiac disease that we see these long-term complications of malabsorption and decreased bone health and also a slight increase in malignancy. So, but there are situations, I mean, I feel like I have to work with my patients the best way that I can, where an individual rightfully says, well, gluten is a poison to me, and you're saying that I have to go back on it to make the diagnosis. And we do our best, and we will monitor the patient the best and make the best call that we can in that situation. Okay, so these blood tests tell us about the immunoreactivity. So it tells us that you consume gluten is causing an immune reaction. Now, the other part of the diagnosis in adults, the looking at the small intestine and sampling the lining of the small intestine is still the gold standard. And what we're looking for are basically loss of that nice velvety mucosa, which is, what we call this is villus flattening, nodularity, scallopy, and mosaic pattern. I will say that in children, there's actually a movement to go away from doing endoscopy, because endoscopy is actually a much bigger deal in a child. It often requires general anesthesia. There are, in Europe, there are certain guidelines that rely on whether the patient has the genes that are associated with celiac disease, whether the level of tissue transglutaminase, if it's over 100, then the likelihood of it being celiac disease is very high, and then response to the gluten-free diet. And that's becoming more and more accepted as an alternative in adults, because really endoscopy is very well tolerated and safe. We still rely on endoscopy, but I think one day we may actually come to that as well. Again, to remind you what it looks like endoscopically, this is a capsule endoscopy where we have patients swallow a camera, and it takes pictures as it tumbles in the small intestine. And they actually give you nice pictures because we don't put air in there, so we see exactly what it normally looks like. And in normal, again, you have that nice villous carpet, whereas in celiac disease, you lose that. And what you have is more edematous, swollen lining, and you don't see the villi. You also see gaps in between, this moth-eaten appearance that we call scalloping, and you see it here also in profile. And there's a way to grade it histologically or under the microscope. Again, to orient you to what you're looking at is under the microscope, the way you look at it is these are the villi that are basically the peaks, and the crypts would be the valleys. And again, the cells that make up the villi are made here in the crypt. And the MARCH criteria is the most common quantitative way to measure cell damage. And what it looks like at is how tall the villi are, how deep the crypts are, how much inflammation there is in the epithelial cells, and how much inflammation there is in the lamina propria, as well as the morphology. So in MARCH 0, which is normal, you have very nice tall villi, very short crypts, where the ratio of the villi to the crypt is about 4-1. And in the most severe form, which is grade 3C, what you see is like the villi are completely gone. These are crypts that are very deep. You have a lot of inflammation both in the lamina propria and in the epithelial cells. And that's a very severe celiac lesion. One thing that I like to say, though, is that there are limitations to the biopsies, because the way the tissue is oriented, and also there's varied experience in pathologists with regards to celiac disease. At Stanford, what we do is when we take the biopsies, we try to orient the tissue on filter paper. So when the pathologist looks at it, the crypts and the villi are aligned. But that's not always, that doesn't happen uniformly. And the other thing is that there are other conditions that could look exactly like celiac disease. So that's why it's important to rely both on these blood tests that document the immune response to gluten and correlate it with what we see endoscopically. It's easier said than done sometimes because it's not very clear cut. And the other part, this is here to remind me to tell you, is that it is important to do this evaluation while the person is consuming gluten, because a lot of these abnormalities will resolve. So the antibodies can normalize. Usually it takes about 6 months to a year. And also the mucosal lining has incredible capacity to regenerate and it heals. So the problem is if somebody has been on a gluten-free diet for a long time and the test is normal, we can't tell if that's treated celiac disease or if the individual doesn't have celiac disease. So whenever we suspect this, it's better to try to do this evaluation immediately so that we could avoid having to restart gluten okay, and because malabsorption is of concern, whenever we diagnose a person with celiac disease, or if we suspect it, then we look for micronutrient deficiencies. We look for whether there's anemia. Some of the tests that we look at are like B vitamins, calcium, zinc, copper, because those are absorbed in the small intestine. Also, deficiencies could cause symptoms, so we like to replete whenever we need to. There is a lot of patients with celiac disease also have thyroid dysfunction, so we're vigilant of that. We are also vigilant of bone health, and we generally advise having a bone mineral density test within 6 months to a year after starting a gluten-free diet. And in general, whenever possible, I do recommend that patients take calcium and vitamin D whenever possible. And that they have routine health care, preventive health. Now, I put pneumococcal vaccine here, but really it's because there's a small percentage of individuals where they have what we call splenic hypofunction, and they may be at higher risk for developing infections with encapsulated organisms. And so In situations when people have a lot of infections and get sick easily, it may make sense to give a pneumococcal vaccine. Now, the gluten-free diet, and I know I'm not going to do it justice here, but what one thing that is important in celiac disease is to have in clinical practice, it's difficult to go over the medical components and also counsel on the gluten-free diet. So it's very important to have individual or dietitians that are expert in celiac disease. It's incredibly important. And unfortunately, that resource is lacking in a lot of places. Because really, I work very closely with the dietitians to help the patients actually master the gluten-free diet, because it's not easy. There's obvious sources of gluten, but there's hidden sources. And one of the myths that we hear a lot is that wheat-free is gluten-free. So sometimes when patients aren't getting better and we go over the diet, and we, in some individuals, are scanning for wheat-free, which is not the same as gluten-free, because remember that gluten is also found in barley and rye. And gluten-free products are wheat-free, but wheat products are not necessarily gluten-free. And there are hidden sources. A lot of people know soy sauce. So there is no gluten in soy itself, but there is soy sauce, in the condiment soy sauce there is. And one thing that keeps on coming up time and again in my clinical practice is that a lot of individuals don't realize that medications and vitamin fillers could be a source of gluten. And I always tell everybody this story about a person where we couldn't figure out where they were getting gluten, and they had been on a blood pressure medication for years. And then we traced it back to the manufacturer, changed the whoever provided the filler, and we traced it back that that lot number of this medication that she had now had gluten. So it could be incredibly difficult, and we struggle to find pharmacists that have any expertise in this, and a lot of times either my staff or the patients have to call manufacturers themselves to try to figure out if the product is gluten-free. So we could do a lot better in this department. We encourage patients to eat, to try grains that are not, that innately don't contain gluten. And I am actually more of a fan of preparing your own foods rather than relying on processed foods, because we do rely on a labeling system. And although gluten-free products are supposed to have less than 20 parts per million of gluten, they also many times substitute gluten with equally offensive carbohydrates or FODMAPs. So when patients are not doing well, then we try to go to the basics and eat natural foods and products, and I think could be really helpful. And one of the big challenges that we have is this problem when an individual is on a gluten-free diet and trying to figure out why aren't they better. Unfortunately, we don't have a standardized way of monitoring adherence. And right now, nutritionists or medical provider with expertise on the celiac disease and the gluten-free diet remains the gold standard. Those diagnostic tests that I told you about that are so good at diagnosing the disease are less reliable when it comes to monitoring the disease activity. And we don't really know the kinetics and when there's an exposure to gluten, when those antibodies are going to become positive. That at last year's GI conference, there was some data presented that seemed to suggest that the antibodies become positive around 2 weeks, but it's variable. And we don't advocate doing an endoscopy every time there's symptoms, because obviously it's costly, and we don't want to put the patient through the risk of a procedure if it's not necessary. So we definitely have to work more on trying to get other ways to monitor the disease. Now, Daniel Leffler, who is a colleague with me at Harvard Medical School, looked at a group of patients that did not respond to the gluten-free diet and broke down as to what the cause was. And the majority of patients was that they were getting continued gluten exposure somewhere. So that's always one of the things. So if somebody's not getting better, one of the first things that we do is go through the diet with a fine-tooth comb, with a dietitian that has expertise in the gluten-free diet, and try to see if there's a problem. There is an overlap syndrome where patients with celiac disease may also have superimposed irritable bowel syndrome. But also, some individuals have lactose intolerance or fructose intolerance. Some individuals also develop what's called small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. Now, that's not an infection. It's more that bacteria that normally reside in the colon, in a sense, set up shop in the small intestine. It's more of a matter of being in the wrong place at the wrong time. And it can cause gas, bloating, and diarrhea. And it's something that we sometimes test, and if present, we may treat with an antibiotic. Some individuals with celiac disease also have microscopic colitis. And microscopic colitis, interestingly, is an inflammatory process in the colon. So if we do a colonoscopy, it looks perfectly normal. But if we biopsy, we see microscopic inflammation that doesn't look very different from what we see in the intestine and celiac disease. But it doesn't, in some cases, it is gluten sensitive. Other cases can be a challenge, and we sometimes have to treat with some anti-inflammatory therapy. Now, 10% was due to refractory celiac disease. And the aggressive forms of celiac disease that are rare include ulcerative jejunitis or lymphoma. So when we talk about refractory celiac disease, there's two varieties. So if you remember from the slide that I showed you about the pathophysiology, there's some specialized cells that kind of migrate and place themselves in between the epithelial cells. These are called intraepithelial lymphocytes. And in refractory sprue, they play a role. So in type 1, these intraepithelial lymphocytes are phenotypically normal, i.e. they still have the normal markers of these normal cells. And generally, patients with this do well. Sometimes we may need to treat with immunosuppressive therapy, but for the most part, the prognosis is very good. What we worry about is type 2, where these intraepithelial lymphocytes mutate and they lose cell surface markers. And this is a premalignant condition. These are the individuals that we're very vigilant about because we're worried about enteropathy-associated T-cell lymphoma and also adenocarcinoma. Unfortunately, there's no cure for this. There is some promising clinical trials at the Mayo Clinic with something called anti-IL-15 therapy that seems to be well-tolerated and seems to work. So in terms of the treatment objective here, it's an anagram of celiac disease, so consultation with a skilled dietitian, I can't say enough how important it is. Also, education about the disease. Some of my patients are here and they know that we sit down and we go over the pathophysiology, and I think it helps to understand what's happening. At the moment, lifelong adherence to a gluten-free diet is the mainstay of therapy. And it's important to identify and treat nutritional deficiencies. So one of the things that we do is we check for these deficiencies, we treat them, and then once a year, depending on the symptoms, we may check different nutritional deficiencies. It also gives us a clue of how active the disease is. And access to advocacy groups and continuous long-term follow-up by a multidisciplinary team. So I do share my patients with the dietitian, with endocrinologists, and depending of what aspects come up, sometimes with neurologists and such. So one thing that's very exciting to me is that finally, I think that not in the not very far future, we're going to have other therapies that would be different from just the dietary therapy. And this slide, I chose this slide because it brings us back to the pathophysiology. And basically the novel therapies are directed at different aspects of the pathophysiologic pathway. So there are approaches where modifying gluten so to make it so that it's not immunogenic. There's also a peptide that is in clinical trials right now, which is a peptidase that made by bacteria that actually breaks down gluten further. And the idea is that if you break it down small enough, then it cannot activate the immune response. Another that is in clinical trials, I think this one just closed and is being analyzed right now, is a protein that makes the junctions between the cells a little tighter. And the idea there is to try to prevent gliadin from getting in there where the immune cells are in the first place. There's also, as I mentioned, for refractory sprue, anti-IL-15 therapy, which targets these epithelial cell, intraepithelial lymphocytes that are important in refractory sprue. But very excitingly, there's work on the development of a vaccine. And this is mainly for patients who carry the more common gene, the HLA-DQ2.5. And the idea there is to kind of trick the immune cells so that it won't react every time that it sees gluten. So the idea there is to develop tolerance. So right now, the problem with gluten is that it's immunogenic. But if you can make it so that you dampen that response and now the immune cells don't react to gluten, then theoretically, if that works, then you may someday be able to eat gluten. Now, wanted to tell you a little bit about our research efforts at Stanford, because we're also trying, again, this is that slide with the pathophysiology. And what we're interested in is to see what sets this all in motion. So one of the things that's not clearly understood is, like, remember, only about 4 to 5% of the genetically predisposed individuals develop celiac disease. And we don't know why that is. And one of the prevailing theories is perhaps that early in life, there is an immune response to something completely independent of gluten. And that causes enough increase in permeability to allow a flux of gliadin in to start that cascade. And there's some circumstantial evidence. For instance, there is some evidence to suggest that children who have are exposed to infections in childhood, such as rotavirus, are more likely to develop celiac disease. And also, anecdotally, we see patients who develop celiac disease after having a viral gastroenteritis, say, and case reports where bacterial gastroenteritis has led to a patient being diagnosed with celiac disease. Also trying to understand what the contributions of the epithelial cells themselves is to celiac disease and understand the T cell repertoire in hopes of developing new diagnostic tests. So one of the coolest projects that I'm involved in, I wanted to share with you, is that we are actually generating what are called organoids, which are, in a sense, little intestines in a petri dish. And organoids are 3D cell structures that resemble the tissue of organ. And this is what you see here. And what you're seeing here is this immunofluorescence of epithelial cells in a petri dish. And the idea here is that from biopsies of patients, we are able to isolate specific intestinal epithelial cells that give rise to all the different cell types. And depending on how you treat these cells, you could either make enterocytes, which are epithelial cells, or the other different cells. So what we're interested in is just making these epithelial cells. So what you have is like little circles, little spheres of intestines. And if this works, it could provide a really powerful system to study celiac disease in a petri dish. And you could envision that if we could reconstitute some part of the immune system, that we may even be able to do these gluten challenges that are so challenging now in clinical practice in a petri dish. Now, in summary, so celiac disease is a complex inflammatory and autoimmune disease. It has a very broad disease spectrum. Celiac disease, wheat allergy, and non-celiac gluten sensitivity are two distinct entities. And the emphasis is that we really have to do a little bit more work in understanding what non-celiac gluten sensitivity is. And that's actually one of my interests, because I think we need to have a better way of identifying who these individuals are and try to figure out what the mechanism is. Celiac disease, so we diagnose celiac disease still by endoscopy and also with the blood test. And so far, the only effective therapy is a strict gluten-free diet, but I think we're going to get adjunctive therapy, and that's very exciting in the near future. And this is our clinic, and thank you so much. I will be happy to answer any questions.
Very much. I have 3 quick questions. One is, I didn't see oat on the list of things
yes.
that are okay to eat.
That was my bad. So the story with oats, I don't know what happened to that slide. I'm sorry about that. But oats also have gluten, and the problem in there is avenins. So the story is that in most patients with celiac disease, oats that are gluten-free are okay. But there are a subset of a minority of patients with celiac disease where they actually react to oats as well. The problem that we have in the United States is cross-contamination, because the oats are processed in the same facilities as wheat. And one thing that I didn't tell you guys is that it actually doesn't take very much wheat to activate the immune response. Studies seem to suggest that as little as 50 to 100 milligrams is enough. And to put things into perspective, a slice of bread has 5 grams, which is 5,000 milligrams. So it really doesn't take a lot. So cross-contamination is really an issue. And in the United States, that tends to be the problem.
So avoid oats.
If you have certified gluten-free oats, those are usually okay. There's only a few patients that I've had to take off oats because most of the time they're okay, though.
The second question is, you mentioned that the blood test had very little false negatives.
Uh-huh.
What about false positives?
So the false positive rate is low, but I do find that in clinical practice that in individuals who have other autoimmune conditions, that sometimes we get a low-grade positive. So there's one of the problems that we have in the field of celiac disease is there's a lot of different kits to look at these antibodies, and so the positive values could be, you know, less than 7 is negative. At Stanford is less than 20. Someplace else is less than 0.4, and they're not really compared one to the next. So it's tough. I think we need to do better, and I think we need to standardize that a little bit better. But every so often, we do get some false positives, and most of the time, somebody has like type 1 diabetes or something else, so there may be a little bit of cross-reactivity. And again, that's why we rely on the whole clinical picture, the endoscopy, the symptoms and the response to gluten. I wouldn't put all of my eggs in one basket.
And the last quick question is, you mentioned diarrhea among the list of symptoms, but not constipation?
Yeah, some constipation could be part. Yes, some people will present with constipation. Some patients have no symptom at all. Yes, ma'am.
We have a problem with our microphone. Can we repeat the question right now?
Okay.
Go ahead.
Go ahead and ask the question. And would you please repeat the question?
Sure.
Do you have like a list of resources for where to buy so that they're not exposed to the wheat?
A list
like
of
products or makers or best brands to buy from so that they don't have the wheat
contamination? Yeah, unfortunately I don't. I'm sorry.
And then my other question would be more around like support groups. If you guys have anything here.
We don't have anything yet. It's in the works. We're working on it. So as of a year and a half ago, I'd say, we did establish a celiac clinic, and we're growing. So we have a dietitian who specializes in GI, but also has pretty extensive experience in celiac disease. And we're hoping that we will recruit more people to join our group so that we could grow more. Yes, ma'am?
The conference that used to be here, the Celiac Conference, is that not going to happen anymore?
Well,
could you repeat that question?
So there used to be a Celiac Conference when I came here, I think it had been done 5 years before, and then I came and there was one, and we haven't had one since, which is 5 years ago. Yeah. So we're trying to reinstitute that. The history of our clinic is that it was started by Dr. Gary Gray, who retired about a year ago. I still get in touch with him every Friday too, because the two of us actually review biopsies ourselves. And he still has this connection to, which is great because I get to work with him on a regular basis. But as he retired, the Celiac Clinic, in a sense, disbanded, and we are in full force now, and there is commitment by the hospital to make sure that it succeeds. So, and also, I have a counterpart in Children's Hospital who is interested in celiac disease in children, and the two of us are trying to work together at seeing if we could reconstitute some of this. So I'm hoping that, yes, someday.
My question is, do you find any correlation between celiac disease and increased UTIs?
No, I haven't, actually.
Oh, I have a separate question, if you're done with that one. My question was, you talked about like the inability to absorb nutrients. Is that only when you consume gluten, or is that a separate symptom of celiacs?
Well, so the inability to absorb nutrients is because when you eat gluten in celiac disease, there are other diseases that could affect the intestine, but in celiac disease, it's repeated exposure to gluten that causes damage to the lining. And if the lining is damaged, then you cannot absorb nutrients. So if that's happening, then it tells us that there's the disease is still active, either because you're still getting gluten somewhere or that you've developed more of a refractory form. Now, other diseases can also cause malabsorption. So like inflammatory bowel disease, and also some other infectious diseases that affect the lining of the intestines.
So once the lining regenerates, you should absorb the nutrients.
Yes, yes. That's the idea.
Thank you, doctor, for being here and for all the information you're giving. If a parent has been diagnosed with celiac disease, when would be a good age for introducing gluten to their child?
That's a great question, and that keeps on changing. So there was a study in Sweden, I think it was, where they changed of when they introduced gluten from 6 months to 4 months, and then what ensued was that there was an epidemic of celiac disease, and then they traced it back to that. But lately there's been conflicting data. In the last report that I read, it doesn't really seem to matter all that much. In quantity may be important, but to be honest, it's not something that I'm really, I think my pediatric colleagues would probably be much better versed there, but it seems like timing is not as important as we thought it was.
I have two questions. The first one is, I've been through, I think now, 3 apps to read the barcode and see if a product is gluten-free. And I haven't found a really trustworthy one. Do you know of a good app?
I haven't found one, a trustworthy one either. And there's also, yep. Well, I don't know that these therapies are not going to include the gluten-free diet, except maybe the vaccine. But I think that the medication that will tighten the junctions is a few years away. And the peptidase, there's already something available in Europe, but it's not the prescription form, and it's the kind of thing that you have to drink like a Coke or something without it, because it has to be the right pH and the right timing for it to work. It's a peptidase. And I haven't seen it, as far as I can tell, it's not available in the United States, but there are clinical trials with the peptidase that I think is going to be a prescription form. So it's in, I think it's going to be starting a phase 3 clinical trial. So hopefully it'll be successful and we'll have access to it.
My second question was about, you asked, there was an answer to an early question that I didn't hear the question.
Oh, sorry.
And so you might have covered it, but the A in celiac, where you listed all these things that you should do, consult and, you know, do these different things. The A was an advocacy group, access to an advocacy group. Is there one?
We don't have one at Stanford. There's the Healthy Villi, which is a web-based one. There are local support groups for by patients, but we haven't had one at Stanford, so
no.
You know, I don't know of one, no.
I think that was our last question.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, this is our last
question.
Okay. Hi, I have a couple quick questions about the testing. When you do you ever do the anti-gliadin antibody?
Yes,
okay, perfect. And then do you do a total IgA with all the testing also for the deficiency? Because it just
Great point. So, yeah. So we always do at Stanford deaminated gliadin peptide, tissue transglutaminase, and a total IgA.
Okay, then do you ever do the tissue transglutaminase 6, or do you use the Cyrex lab testing at all for the testing?
No, we do our in-house just for tissue transglutaminase. We do not do tissue transglutaminase 6, no.
Okay, and then do you also, when you do the biopsies, do you diagnose at MERSH 1, or do you wait until it's MERSH 3 or 4?
Well, it depends on the clinical context, but we are more convinced of the enteropathy when it's more MERSH 3 or 4. Although at my institution, they don't use MERSH criteria, so a lot of times I wind up reviewing the slides on my own to determine whether I think it's celiac disease or not, if I'm convinced.
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you. Great.